Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Welcome to our concert this evening. To the strains of the Royal Logistical Regimental March, please welcome our compere for this evening, Major Rob Marshall. The standard bearers from the Royal British Legion, Cadet Lance Corporal Peter Turner Wells and Cadet Lance Corporal Will Nicholson. This, the 75th commemoration of the Battle of Britain. I'd like to welcome His Worshipful, the Mayor of Runnymede, Councillor Derek Cotty and Mayoress Susan Jones, the Armed Forces Champion for Runnymede, Councillor Shannon Sace Marshall, and the rest of you. Have a fantastic evening of music tonight. Now, there is a break halfway through. It'll be 20 minutes. When I signal, you need to depart to the bar. I drink bitter. Then on my shout, please come and take your seats, because we need to get the second half in. Now tonight, you'll be accompanied by the fantastic Egham Band. I'm sure some of you have seen them before. Now I'm going to introduce the band, but not by name. I've decided tonight to give them groupings. So, they'll raise their hand as they're introduced. First of all, we have the percussion section, who tonight are the ground crew. Nothing gets off the ground without the ground crew, most vital part of the RAF. Nothing flies. Next we have the cornets. Fighter command. Always in there first. Daring do's. And risking life. The hornets and flugel. Tonight, radar monitors. Signalling the way for better things to come. Baritones and euphonium. Rear gunners. Not always mentioned, never forgotten, and vital to back you up. Trombones. Tonight's air traffic control, guiding us through the tunes and ensuring we stay on track. And lastly, bases. The daring bomber command. You wait for them, you know they're coming, and then you get them. It wouldn't be the same without tonight's lead of the band, of course, who tonight is Wing Commander Gareth Green. Without further ado then, starting us off with the Battle of Britain by Ron Goodwin and William Walton. Shots away! Conflict has so much been owed to so many by so few. What a fantastic start. Our next tune was written for the movie Battle of Britain, the aces referring to those daring pilots. Now, since the formation of the Royal Flying Corps in 1914, some 26 aircrew have won the Victoria Cross. During the Battle of Britain, only one airman was awarded the Victoria Cross, and that was Flight Lieutenant Eric Nicholson. And he was in a dogfight over the Solent when his aircraft was hit by four cannons, shells. The cockpit burst into flames and he was forced to bail out. Just as he released his seatbelt, he noticed the Luftwaffe about to attack Southampton. and he pulled himself back into the cockpit with his hands on fire to hold down the triggers until the enemy aircraft was downed. He then released the cockpit and deployed his parachute and deployed what he thought was safely to ground, but unfortunately, some overzealous members of the Home Guard opened fire on him as he descended. So this one's for all the heroes, and another Ron Goodwin song, Aces High. It's For Valor. The Fallen was written for the film Saving Private Ryan in 1998 by John Williams. The film was inspired by a book by Robert Rodart after he passed by a memorial in New Jersey with the names of 8 siblings on it. Now, it's not uncommon. In the First World War, we had a group of brothers called the Fighting Bradfords, 3 of whom were lost in battle and only 1 came home. They were the highest decorated family ever in the United Kingdom, with 2 Victoria Crosses, 2 Military Crosses, and a Distinguished Service Order between them. Now, in commemoration of D-Day, and yes, there's another impression coming up here, from the words of Eisenhower, "This operation is not planned with any alternatives. This operation is planned as a victory, and that's the way it's gonna be." 633 Squadron was a fictional fighter bomber squadron in their efforts to destroy a V2 rocket fuel dump. The RAF didn't actually form a 633 Squadron, and much of the film was mirrored on 613 Squadron. The film managed to reflect the many nationalities that were involved in the fighting. Canadian, Norwegian, Indian, New Zealand and Australian, to name a few. Considered to be one of the top 100 war films in history, let them have it, chaps. Luft 3 was situated 100 miles south of Berlin, and it was chosen specifically because it was impossible to escape from. Two attempts were made. Firstly, the wooden horse, in where a PT box was taken out to the training area and one man tried to dig a tunnel out. This failed. Later on, and more famously, the Great Escape happened. On the night of Friday the 24th of March 1943, an attempt by 200 airmen from different countries was made to breach the wire of Stalagraf 3. 76 men that night managed to escape. The 77th, who was squadron leader Tren VC, surrendered at the woodline. Three men made it all the way back to UK. Unfortunately, the remainder were captured. And worse still, and unfortunately to that, 50 airmen were executed that night. With a theme from The Great Escape by Elmer Bernstein, this is To Tom, Dick and Harry. known as a whistling part and auditioned. Now this song was written in 1939 and it's been performed by a range of artists such as Bobby Darin, Catherine Jenkins, Petula Clark, Twiggy, Rod Stewart, but most memorably, Dame Vera Lynn, DBE. As soon as it was, as A Nightingale Sang in Berkeley Square was released, it became the love tune for the forces. And being such a love tune, I often quote it to my wife. I may be right, I may be wrong, but I'm perfectly willing to swear. That night when you turned and smiled at me, a nightingale sung in Chertsey, just by the Costa. This one is for all the lovers. Eagles there, is one of the most stunning scores written by Ron Goodwin. But despite many inaccuracies in the film, it was a stunning success. For instance, in the first scene, they used an American Bell helicopter, which actually wasn't invented until 1946. And the meeting of the Allies on Crete in 1942 couldn't have happened because the Germans invaded Crete in 1941. However, Goodwin can be credited with scoring all 20 of the tunes for this amazing film, making it one of the most exciting soundtracks of its time. So, we're with the theme tune from Where Eagles Dare. It's Broadsword Calling Danny Boy. Come in, Danny Boy. Evening, we have a London celebration by Peter Graham. Between the 7th of September 1940 and the 21st of May 1941, over 100 tons of high explosives were dropped on 16 cities in the UK. London was hit 71 times. It was continually bombed for 57 nights in a row. However, Goring didn't succeed in breaking the war production, nor, more importantly, the morale of the nation. And it was famously said that if the British Empire and its Commonwealth stand for 1,000 years, let men say, this is their finest hour.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being seated so promptly. And welcome to the second half of our show. And no, we have not put the band through a hot wash. This is the Egham Training Band. And you're about to be entertained by three pieces of music. The first one then. Well, the Home Guard were formed in 1940. And they comprised of 1.5 million volunteers, including women of the Home Defence Force. Stationed mainly on the coast, they did actually have a very serious job. And they were in charge of the anti-aircraft guns, shooting down numerous Luftwaffe and the dreaded V1 doodlebugs. Over 1,200 men lost their lives on duty during the course of the Second World War. And when they left the Home Guard, they were presented with a simple certificate that said, in the years when our country was in mortal danger, he gave generously of his time and powers to make himself ready for her defence with his life if need be. Now, with a theme from Dad's Army by Jimmy Perry and Derek Taverner, there's nothing else to say but, don't panic, Mr. Marin, because we're all doomed. Training Band were formed in 2010 and has over 20 talented young players from ages 9 to 14. They've played at many local occasions under their musical director, who's now retired, of Stuart Gordian, a retired Sergeant Major of the Band of the Welsh Guards. Now I believe Stuart's in tonight, isn't he? Stuart? That's right. Now, they readily welcome new players on all instruments, in particular cornet players. You must be able to read music and have some sort of musical tuition. But this is the sort of thing we should be promoting in Runnymede, is youth and the orchestra, the band like this, the talent that they produce. They rehearse on Monday evenings, 6:30 to 7:30, and anyone is interested, or parents, then please see one of the band members afterwards. Now, the next two pieces to finish off are The House of the Rising Sun by Gary Young and Double Chocolate Rumba by Bruce Fraser. Please welcome the Egham Training Band.
Thank you.
And I can hear them laughing nervously as well. Because the curtains are just about to open now. In a minute. Hey, look at that. Now, luckily, we have our very talented vocalist, Mr. Barry Ordsley, to accompany you tonight in the Keep Smiling Through medley by William Walton. I'm trying to talk as slowly as I can so that the band can be ready. And we're now on vocals with Some Sunny Day.
This guy, so please join me. Thank you.
Yeah. happy to know that as you saw me go, I was singing this song.
Mr. Barry Orton. Wake up, innit? Now that was a sound that filled men's hearts with fear and excitement as they ran panicked towards their Spitfires, knowing that within a few minutes they'd be facing the enemy over the skies of Britain. Now, the iconic aircraft of the Second World War was, of course, the Supermarine Spitfire, powered by two Rolls-Royce Merlin engines with their unmistakable noise. And I can still hear them in my ears when you know, when it passes overhead. I was at RAF Northolt for 4 years, and we used to have the Battle of Britain flight fly across every now and again. And once you hear the Spitfire once, you'll never forget the sound. Armed with 8 303 Browning Mark III machine guns, able to deliver 350 rounds per minute per gun, they were the most formidable aircraft in the skies. Over 20,000 were built during the Second World War at a cost of £12,000 each. And most villages and towns held fundraisers and bought their own. There are only 55 left today, each costing £1.7 million apiece. And they still take the air as they did 3 weeks ago on the Battle of Britain flight. With a Spitfire prelude by William Walton, written in 1942 in recognition of this great aircraft, all I can say is scramble, scramble, scramble.
Thank you.
Overpaid, oversexed, and over here. And thank goodness they were. And it's a tribute to all of the men who volunteered from other countries. For example, a young man during the beginning of the Second World War lived in a small settlement in Canada called The Paw, which is in northern Manitoba. He had to travel over 600 miles through bear-infested and wolf-infested territory just to sign on for a war that actually wasn't his. Being a hunter by trade, he was snapped up and was sent to UK. He trained in the UK and during training was shot twice. He had a brief affair and fell in love with a lady and then was sent to D-Day. He never returned, but he wasn't killed. He was sent back to Canada to The Paw, where he had no communication and couldn't get in touch with the lady he loved. We're very privileged to have the granddaughter of Sergeant Peter Partridge from the Royal Canadian Artillery with us tonight. And it's just a tribute to all those people who volunteered throughout the world and came and helped the British forces. One of them was Glenn Miller, but he was too old to join. He was refused. He had to go and persuade Brigadier General Charles Young that he could come and do something for the war effort, even if it was only conducting. And with him, he brought a certain magic. Now with the Miller magic tonight, we have the band doing the whole compilation and bringing a smile to everyone's face. All I'd say is, let's swing. Thank you. Well, that raised our spirits a bit, didn't it? Seems why not. The Battle of Britain lasted from the 10th of July to the 31st of August, sorry, October 1940. Only 3 months and 3 weeks. 1,542 Allied and 2,698 aircraft air crew were killed. Over 5,000 aircraft destroyed and 90,000 civilians were injured. Nimrod forms the beginning tune played at the beginning of the Cenotaph Remembrance Day Parade each year. And it is Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II's favourite tune. With Nimrod by Edward Elgar, 1899, we will remember them.
Thank you.
we draw near to the end. This tune was traditionally played at the end of the military working day and the lowering of the flags. Now a regular part of the beating retreat, it was first performed in 1932 by the mass bands of the Bugles of the Mediterranean Fleet. We're about to hear Sunset by Captain Arthur Green, followed straight away by the National Anthem. But to start Sunset, in some dark distant corner, as a couple of you know, there'll be a horrible looking Psalm Major, finishing the day with the following words.
Fall out!
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Now, standard bearers, fall out. Now, thank you for a wonderful evening of music. However, in the interval, I was having a chat with a few of you, and there was one song missing. Now, I've had a word with the band, and I think we can fit it in. But this next tune was an inspiration for school children all over the country to don a vital piece of equipment. Now, this bit of equipment transformed them from humble school children to daring fighter pilots. And I know there are some younger people in the audience tonight, and for their benefit, I will now demonstrate the hand goggles. Now, of course, I only have one hand goggle on, because it must have been a pretty terrifying fight. However, Bomber Command was a very dangerous place to work. Average life expectancy, 7 missions. If they survived 30, they were sent on leave forcibly. And it was only right that Her Majesty the Queen unveiled the commemoration to Bomber Command on the 28th of June 2012. The Dam Busters March is iconic of this, written by Eric Coates in 1955. And to finish off tonight, thank you, God bless, and safe home. All I can say is, bombs away, chaps.
right with the news about. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. For me, a very quick thank you to everyone for coming. It's been very, very good to see so many people here. Very much appreciate Major Robert Marshall doing what he's done tonight. It's superb. It's very much been hard to read. So thank you very much. A great many people put a great deal of work into this evening, as you can probably imagine, and it would be really silly to try and go through all the names. So please, on behalf of the Egan Band, on behalf of the audience, thank you all, everybody, for the work that you've actually done for this evening. And just, I've had quite a number of Facebook messages, I've had a number of emails and quite a few comments. If you look on the back page of your programme, which I'm sure you've all got, there's a picture there of the Home Guard Band of 1941, and I'm not either of the two trombone players, despite what some of you have said. A band is an organic animal as far as we're concerned. We keep trying to grow, and obviously depending on the personnel, we keep trying to play better and better for ourselves and for yourselves. You've seen Egan Training Band 1 tonight. There is an Egan Training Band 2 starting, so if you have, as I said earlier, young children interested and have some idea of what playing a brass instrument is all about, please come and see us. As it's an organic instrument, as it's an organic group, obviously we have to say goodbye to people occasionally. And we have somebody with us tonight playing percussion who has been with us for a very long time, joined us before he was married, he now has three children. It's been great having you with us, Ian. We have a little something for you from the band. Gareth, if you would be so kind. There's a metronome. That's so good. Obviously, a musical audience. Okay, I know you all want to go home. Thank you all very much for coming. We hope to see you again soon.